السلام عليكم.
تفضلنا. Now I have brought some papers. Don't you see this? Yesterday, you asked me some questions. Is required a sharp memory for years, which I don't have. My memory is otherwise sharp, but not for years. So I made a few mistakes. I was not sure of some certain years. So I asked Imam Sahib to prepare year-wise list of important events. If you ask me now about certain events, I can tell you exactly in which year they took place. The corrections which I must make. Number one, as far as the year of birth is concerned, obviously, of course, that is
1835.
There's no doubt about it. But, and as far as his commissioning is concerned, there is no doubt he was first time commissioned by God in 1882. As far as the death of his father is concerned, it was in 76. I said 64, 65, this was wrong.
76.
76. Right?
Yes.
So these are the important years to be corrected. And his visit to Sialkot took place early, much earlier than his father's death. It was in 64. So it was that visit, you know, which confused me. I knew it was an important year. So it was not the year of his father's death, but the year when he went for the first time to Sialkot to serve there. Now you remember, perhaps, that he claimed to be the promised Messiah in early 91 or 90, end of 90. So his first contact with the Christians was established in 64. And between this and that, how many years is that?
27.
About 27, 26 to 27 years.
That means, Hadur, that he was in Sialkot, he was about 31, the age of 31.
Yes, that's right. And 30. I think it was about less than 29.
From 35 to 64.
Yes.
29.
Just 29
years. Not 31, but 29.
Sorry.
One year was added on the
wrong
side.
Yes.
He was 29 when he visited Sialkot, and there he had his first contact with Christian missionaries in representing Islam against Christianity. And throughout his tenure of 4 years, this was his main occupation. Outside the work at the courts, he continued engaged in his debates in favor of Islam, most often with Christians and many a time with Hindus and Sikhs and others.
How long did he stay in this job? 4 years?
4 years.
4 years. And 68 he retired.
And his father died 6 years, 8 years after.
He was in 41, in the age of 41 when his father died.
That's right.
Okay.
He was already
living. Yes.
Now, a very interesting point, I asked Imam Sahib to calculate, I thought there would be a similarity between the contact of Hazrat Muhammad with Christians in Syria and the time distance between that and his claim. So there could have been a similarity, because I know that the Orientalists allege that his knowledge of religion was received from Christian fathers. And because of that, he claimed to be a prophet later on. So the seed of prophethood was sown by the Christian fathers. In the other way, he represented those Christian fathers, in fact, not God. So, because I knew Hazrat Mishra Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a humble servant of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so there would be some similarity on this issue as well. Now, interestingly, his first contact with the Christians was made when he was
13 years old.
Rasulullah Sallam visited Syria along with his uncle.
Yes.
Which one?
Abu Talib.
Which was the Christian?
Buhaira Rahib.
His first contact was made when he was 13 years old with Buhaira Rahib Buhaira. Buhaira is the name of the Rahib. And that was in Syria. All books of history record this. And what is the difference between 40 and 13?
27.
About the same difference. Which occurs between the claim of the Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam to be the Messiah and the first contact in Sialkot.
Yeah.
Don't you see?
Yes, but the Holy Prophet visited Syria again or Palestine again.
I know, as but the first contact.
Yes, this is the first contact. Yes, yes.
That was repeated later on. So Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam contact with the Christians was a continuous affair
all throughout his life. Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Now, these corrections had to be made. Yeah. Another correction about the year and things. I was under the impression that the first ilham of Hazrat Masih was before, just before the death of his father. But in one of the books of his biography, because I wanted to be sure of all these things, I asked them to find out from different biography books of biography of Masih what was the first ilham. Now we have discovered that it was earlier. The first ilham, that is revelation, was earlier. It was in 1960, end of 68 or early 69. 18, not 20. End of 1868 or early 69. This was a ilham of approval of his attitude and righteousness. What happened was that Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Batalvi, who later on became a sworn enemy of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, he was an Ahle Hadith. Those who give preference to Hadith for everything else, they would interpret the Quran in the light of Hadith, not the other way around. And he, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, belonged to Hanafis. He was a Hanafite by birth, but his family was a Hanafi family. So other Hanafites, and they were in majority, they knew that he was a great scholar, because by that time, at this time, by 1869, his fame was spreading around that he has a deep knowledge of Islam. So they convinced him to represent them in a debate between the Hanafites and the Ahle Hadith. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam was carried by a huge crowd who was applauding, you know, as their hero. And they entered the mosque in such mood. Maulvi Muhammad Hussain was sitting with a few of his followers. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, before starting the debate blindly, he said, "Maulvi Sahib, I want to find out what your views are on the following issues before we enter the debate. Do you think the Quran is Qazi or Hadith is Qazi? Who is the judge?" Maulvi Sahib said, "The Quran is the judge." As Mr. Salaam said, "Then if a Hadith is contradictory to the Quran, which will you follow?" He said, "The Quran." He said, "This is my faith. What is the debate about?" Now, he knew that the people who brought him will be very angry. They will think that he has run away from the debate, but there was nothing left in it. So they were, actually, you know, they disliked it and they grumbled and mumbled and went away. Very unhappy people that looked at him. We brought him in such a... He did it for the sake of God, for the sake of truth. So he received the first revelation from Allah that God has become very pleased. God is very pleased with your righteous attitude. And a time would come when kings will seek blessing from your clothes. that famous, world famous in fact, Ilham o Masih Maud Sadat Islam, Badshah Tere Kapon Se Barakat Dhoondenge, was that a part of that Ilham, that revelation, which was bestowed upon him in 1869, early 69 or late 68. These are the corrections. Here I am available to you again.
I have to yes, to make these corrections for us. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بالأمس كنا نتحدث عن مؤسس الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية سيدنا ميرزا غلام أحمد، وكنا نتحدث عن حضور تحدث عن أخلاقه وصفاته الأولى في شبابه الباكر، ووصلنا إلى أنه ذهب إلى مدينة أو بلدة سيالكوت حيث كان يعمل كاتبا في إحدى المحاكم أو في محكمة سيالكوت، وعمل بها 4 سنوات في وظيفة كاتب وهي وظيفة بسيطة. وكان في هذا الوقت يصطدم بهؤلاء المسيحيين والدعاء إلى المسيحية الذين كانوا يتصيدون المسلمين في هذه المحكمة، فكان يقف مناضلا ويرد عليهم بل ويستطيع أن يتغلب عليهم، إلى أن علم أنه مأمور من الله وتلقى الوحي من الله، وكانت رؤياه دائما ومشاهداته كانت تكون دائما صادقة كالفجر.
المأمورية في 1882.
نعم. This is the مأمورية as the promised Messiah. Or no. Just مأمور.
Just مأمور. Without any explanation.
نعم نعم نعم.
I'm going to appoint you. نعم. To commission you for something.
نعم. كان أمير المؤمنين أخبر أن الوحي الأول الذي تلقاه المسيح الموعود عند وفاة والده أو قبيل وفاة والده، وهو الآية القرآنية التي تقول والسماء والطارق، ولكن
يستفعل والسماء والطارق.
نعم فقط.
فقط.
نعم.
فقط.
Yes. هذا ليس
معذرة
فقط السماء والطارق، ومنها فهم سيدنا الإمام المهدي أن هناك طارق سوف يأتي وأن والده سوف يموت. وثم بعد ذلك جاء الوحي بأليس الله بكاف عبده، عندما فكر في وفاة والده والمسائل الرزق الدنيوي، وكان هذه الآية أليس الله بكاف عبده هي الجواب الحاسم أنه لا يفكر في هذا الموضوع مرة أخرى. يقول أمير المؤمنين أننا بحثنا في المراجع فوجدنا أنه تلقى الوحي قبل ذلك وهو في سن أصغر من ذلك، عندما كان في سيالكوت في حوالي عام 1868 و69. كان هناك أحد العلماء أهل الحديث ويسمى محمد حسين البطالوي، وكان هذا الرجل عالم لأهل الحديث، ولكن طائفة من المسلمين تعتقد بأن الحديث هو الأهم، فكانوا يحكمون على القرآن بالحديث لدرجة أنهم يغيرون معنى الآية ويفهمونها فهما مغايرا لمعناها الحقيقي بناء على الحديث. كان حضرة المسيح الموعود كان في ذلك الوقت من المذهب الحنفي، لأن آبائه وأهله والمجموعة من أهل المذهب الحنفي، واشتهر في ذلك الوقت بأنه رجل عالم يعرف كثيرا في الدين، فطلبوا منه أن يمثل الأحناف في مناقشة مع السيد محمد حسين البطالوي في هذا الموضوع، وذهبوا إلى المسجد في مجموعة من الناس يهللون وفرحين به ينتظرون هذا اللقاء الكبير. وقبل المناظرة سأل حضرة المسيح الموعود السيد محمد حسين البطالوي، قال له قبل أن ندخل في هذه المناقشة أريد أن أسألك سؤالين. السؤال الأول، ما رأيك، هل القرآن أم الحديث هو الحكم؟ قال القرآن هو الحكم، هو الذي هو القاضي الذي يحكم. قال حسنا، هذا هو رأيي أيضا. ثانيا، لو تناقض الحديث مع القرآن فبمن تأخذ؟ قال أخذ بالقرآن. قال إذن هذا رأيي، ففيما سنتناقش؟ ليس هناك مجال إذن للمناظرة، لأن هذه عقيدتي، وإذا كانت هذه عقيدتك فهذا صحيح، إذن لا مجال هناك لهذه المناقشة. طبعا هذا خيب آمال أولئك الذين كانوا ينتظرون موقعة من الجدل بين القطبين، ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى رضي منه هذا الموقف
وأوحى إليه ألهمه أنه سعيد ومسرور بتصرفه هذا. وضمن هذا الوحي جاء الوحي الذي يقول سوف تتبارك الملوك من ثيابك، أي أنه حتى ثيابه ستكون بركة لهؤلاء الملوك. وأستطيع أن أقول قبل أن يخبرنا أمير المؤمنين أن هذا رأيته وشهدته بنفسي، وقد تباركت الملوك فعلا بثيابه. النقطة التالية أنه أمر أو سمي مأمورا من عند الله، وقال له أنك مأمور دون تحديد ما هي هذه المأمورية، ولكن المأمور من الله هو شخص عليه مسؤولية لابد أن يؤديها. كان ذلك في عام 1890 أو في أواخر عام هذا العام أو في عام 1891.
But he was appointed as Masih al-Ma'ud, al-Masih al-Ma'ud in 1891.
Soon after this, after being Ma'mur.
Ma'mur was 82.
82, Commissioner.
Not soon.
82.
Nine years after.
I made another mistake.
أصحح مرة أخرى أن سيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود عين مأمورا من قبل الله في عام 1882، ووصل إلى أن أصبح المسيح الموعود في عام 1891، أي بعد ذلك بتسع سنوات.
Now it is perhaps end of 1890 or beginning of 1891, because the book in which he claims was published early in 1891. Is that right?
يقول أمير المؤمنين أن الموعد الكتاب الذي أعلن فيه المطبوع الذي أعلن فيه أنه المسيح الموعود كان في أول عام 1891، فمعنى ذلك أنه عين مسيحا موعودا في أواخر أو في آخر عام 1890. We are now with the promised Messiah when he was in Sialkot and not yet as a Ma'mur. Yes. And Hudur explained some
64.
Yes, some of his
we
want to know a full picture as much as we can about what he did with the people, the Muslims, non-Muslims.
You see, what happened was he spent his time in the court, and as he finished the job, a few hours work, he was already famous for his debates on behalf of Islam. That was his life. He sometimes sat late after midnight discussing Islam and contesting with others the superiority of Islam. And in this he made a wide circle and wide acquaintance of the knowledgeable people of Sialkot at that time. His major contests or debates were with the Christians, not only within the court but outside the Sialkot. He went on debating the verities of the Quran and the Islam as against the Old and New Testament, etc., etc. And also with the Hindus and other people of other faiths. So he made his name as a stalwart of Islam, as a warrior fighting the cause of Islam. And no other occupation is ever reported during that period. Either he would go to the court, or we would discuss Islam and study Islam and represent the beauty of Islam and Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course the nights were spent largely in prayers and so on.
في هذه الفترة في سيالكوت من عام 1864 إلى عام 1868 كان يعمل بضع ساعات بالنهار في هذا العمل في المحكمة، أما بقية اليوم وربما أثناء العمل أيضا كان دائما ملتحما في نقاش مع غير المسلمين ليدافع عن كمال الإسلام وجمال القرآن، كأنه تخصص في هذه الناحية. فكان يلتقي بالدعاء المسيحية وغيرهم من الهندوس واشتهر بين العلماء في هذه البلدة أنه هو كأنه بطل مدافع دائما عن الإسلام. ولم يكن له عمل سوى هذا الأمر، طبعا إلى جانب مكثه بالمسجد والصلاة والتعبد وقيام الليل، ولكن العمل الأساسي كان هذا الصراع والنقاش دفاعا عن الإسلام، بل وهجوما على أعداء الإسلام، مبينا أن الإسلام هو الأكمل وهو الأعظم.
You see, there was a great Muslim scholar of Indian fame, if not Indian fame, at least the Punjab and the area around. His name was Maulana Sayyid Mir Hassan Sahib. He used to be in Sialkot during the period when Hazrat Muslim Sadr Islam worked in the courts. So he made a statement which was published. I have taken it from Sayyid al-Mahdi Tawa Awwal. Yes, Bayan ka pata? 1864. I'm talking of the statement. To whom did he deliver the statement? And when was it made public? We don't have the full data on this here in this book at least. But I want to tell you that Maulana Sayyid Mir Hussain Sahib was a great Muslim scholar, highly revered. And he came to know of Masih Maud Islam, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian during that period. Later on, when ulema wanted him to speak against him, he refrained. He never said a word against him. And he gave his witness that I have seen him during that tenure of Hazrat Mirza Sahib in Sialkot. I found him to be an excellent Muslim. Nothing against Islam was ever found in his character, in his bearing. And he always, I'll tell you the words. He speaks that I first came into touch with him when I needed, during a case he was pleading in the court, an Arab interpreter from Arabic to Urdu, who knew Arabic because that was something that I needed. And at that time he could speak Arabic so well and understand it so well that he was impressed. He said, I was surprised to see him, and during that period he saw him as a very pious, righteous young man. So this was one of the testimonies in favor of Hazrat Masih Maud Islam, but he is not the only person.
Where is it published? Is it published in book?
No, this book,
time?
This book is Hayat-e-Tayyiba from Sheikh Abdul Qadir.
Yes.
But that is what I was saying to him. I said, we are quoting an Ahmadi book.
Yes.
But we would like to know who was the first witness who heard it from him.
Yes.
Or when his statement was first published. It is not mentioned here.
Yes, okay.
So let us leave it alone for
Inshallah,
a while.
Inshallah, yes.
Even if we can't produce this, we know certainly that during his tenure of Sialkot, he came into wide contact with all people. And when he claimed to be a prophet or a messiah, none of them stood up and said, we know you, you are the one who lived in Sialkot, you did that and you did that and you. Not a single blemish was cast over his character during that period of his exposure. In Qadian, he remained within a limited society. If he had bad habits, they could be hidden. But in Sialkot, when he was openly exposed to all the critics, because he had started the fights in favor of Islam, for the sake of Islam, everybody looked at him critically. When he claimed to be appointed by God, not a single voice was raised against him, alleging that, oh, you are the man who used to be that, you know, and you behaved this way, and you were unrighteous, and you had that blemish. So that lack of the enemy's attack on his character during relating to that period is a proof enough that he spent his life like the ideally righteous person in Islam.
Especially that he moved from a village to a city.
To a city, yes. Where nobody from that village ever knew him.
يقول أمير المؤمنين.
All these enemies who became like Muhammad Hussain Mutalwi, they knew him from that period onwards.
يقول أمير المؤمنين أن سيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود كان في الفترة من 64 إلى 68 وهو في شبابه الباكر يعمل في مدينة سيالكوت فكانت فرصة طيبة ليخرج إلى العالم لأن أخلاقه وتصرفاته كانت تصرفاته كانت معروفة فقط لأهل قديان ولكن عندما خرج إلى المدينة وخرج إلى سيالكوت واشتغل في المحكمة كانت هناك فرصة ليلتقي مع كثير من الناس من أصناف متعددة هؤلاء الناس اشتهر بينهم على أنه شاب تقي صالح مدافع عن الإسلام وعندما وصل إلى أن اختاره الله مسيحا موعودا وإماما مهديا هؤلاء الناس لم يوافقوه ولكن لم يتهمهم أحد منهم قط بأنه كان على خلق سيء أو أنه كان يفعل أمورا تخالف الإسلام أو أن به أي عيب يشينه في مثل هذا الإدعاء وأشار أمير المؤمنين إلى أن أحد العلماء المسلمين المشهورين ويسمى مولانا مير حسن صاحب ذهب إلى المحكمة وكانت له قضية هناك تحتاج إلى ترجمة إلى اللغة العربية فوجد سيدنا ميرزا غلام أحمد هناك ووجده يستطيع أن يترجم له من الأردية إلى العربية فأعجب به ووجد فيه فصاحة وقدرة على هذا الحديث ومن هناك عرفه وعندما أرادوا أن يتحدث عنه بسوء قال لا أنا شهدته ولا أعرف عنه إلا التقوى والصلاح وهو في شبابه وسوف نجد هذا المرجع غير الأحمدي إن شاء الله في وقت لاحق.
Now another very interesting and I think most important witness in this regard is Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Mutalwi I mentioned earlier. He is the prime enemy after he claimed to be the Prophet Messiah. He became his prime enemy. And he was a very highly revered person among the Ahle Hadith people. And his fame had spread far and wide. He knew Arab scholars and Muslims of great fame in Mecca and Medina and so on. This is the man we're talking about. When Hazrat Masih Maud wrote his first book, in 1880, that was Brahim-e-Ahmadiyya. First part was published in 1880, then second part in the same year, and the third part in 1882, and the fourth in 1884. Right? Now this man, Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Mutalwi, which year is it when he wrote this? But in his own, when he wrote this book in different volumes, commenting on these books in his own newspaper or magazine, which was named Ishaatu Sunnah. It is volume 7, page 169-170. Now because yearly it was published under volumes, one volume, second volume, third volume, so they started counting the pages from the first to the end. So that is why it was a magazine, yet the number of pages is very big, very big.
Here is 1884.
It was in 1884.
Yes, same year.
2 years after Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam had already claimed to have been commissioned by God. Yet he had not claimed to be the Prophet Messiah. So he tolerated up to that. And commenting on this book, he says, "Hamari raay mein ye kitab is zamana mein aur maujooda halaat ki wajah se aisi kitab hai jiski nazir aaj tak Islam mein taleef nahi hui aur aainda ki khabar nahi." In our considered opinion, the book which is under review, his book, Brahin Ahmadiyya, the like of it has never been published before, written by anybody. As far as the future is concerned, Allah knows best. But about the past, we know. We are, scholarly people, we know.
Yes.
No book like this has ever been published before. لَعَلَّ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ أَمْرًا. If Allah, shows something, brings something about, he knows better. He said, "Iska maulif bhi Islam ki mali aur jani, qalmi, lisani, hali, qali, nusrat mein aisa thabit qadam nikla hai, ki jiski nazir pehle musalmanon mein bahut kam paayi gayi." The author of this book, in his sacrifices for the sake of Islam, financial sacrifices, sacrifices in writing, sacrifices in speaking on behalf of Islam, sacrifices in his own person, the very life he style he lived. And to aid and support Islam, he's so foremost and so pronounced, so prominent among the Muslims of all ages, that the like of him is very difficult to find in the entire history of Islam. These are the compliments.
SubhanAllah.
In the whole history of Islam, study Islam, it's very difficult to find the equal to him. Hamare in alfaz ko koi ashiyai mubalagha samjhe, to humko kam se kam ek aisi kitab bata de, isme jumla firqa hai mukhalifin Islam, khususan Arya Abraham samaj se is zor shor se muqabla paya jata hai. That if somebody takes our review to be a case of Asiatic exaggerations, Oriental exaggerations, our retort to that person would be, "All right, bring a single book in which Islam has been so perfect, beautifully defended against all faiths, particularly against the Aryas and Brahmo Samajis, the Hindus of India, who were the predominant in India, and with such vigor and such vitality, and show us, bring the names to us of three or four stalwarts and warriors who fought the battles of Islam like he did." There is no Oriental exaggeration in it. He says, I'm a scholar of Islam, I know, I have an eye on the history of Islam. So I challenge you, bring forth two or three or four, just a few, such people who defended Islam like he is defending, and a book like his book which has ever been published. Now this is not only a testimony, this was a challenge. And not a single person rose to accept this challenge and call his bluff if he took it to be a bluff. See, very interesting statement. Iske alawa nushali nusrat kabhi beeda utha liya ho aur mukhalifin Islam aur munkirin ne ilham ke muqabla mein mardana tahajji ke saath ye dawa kiya ho ki jisko wujood e ilham mein shak ho وہ ہمارے پاس آ کر تجربہ اور مشاہدہ کر لے اور اس تجربہ اور مشاہدہ کا اقوام غیر کو مزہ بھی چکا دیا. What a commitment he made at that time. He said it's not just the writing of the book. He challenged with great courage and outstanding force not only these religions, but those who
were atheists, who did not believe in the existence of God. And he said, all right, come. If you do not believe in the existence of God and in the existence of revelations, come to me and look at me. I am the recipient of revelations. God has been speaking to me. And I can prove to you that my revelations are from God and they are right. He says, he not only did this, he proved it to be the right thing. Imagine. Then this man, out of love of Christ, became his first enemy. Because he tolerated everything but did not tolerate any man who declared that Christ was dead. That was the only crime Mr. Mohd committed in his eyes. It was unpardonable, unforgivable. And what about this ilham, this way which he had proved that he was a man from God, man of God, who received messages from God? What happened to that?
Sheikh Hadur, either he is liar here or liar there. And in both cases we cannot accept it.
It's not acceptable. The first statement is acceptable because it is before the enmity.
Yes, yes.
وَأَنُ الرَّضَىٰ عَنْ كُلِّ إِعَابٍ كَلِيلَةٌ كَمَا أَنَّ أَنَ السُّخْتِ تُبْدِي الْمَسَابِيَ. Before the أَنَ السُّخْتِ, this is what he said. He might have exaggerated, but he proves, he raises this issue. Don't think I do it for love. Love always exaggerates. But here are the two reasons why I say it is not exaggeration.
What is the number of the page, Hadur, please? 169?
169.
170. Yes, sir. Okay.
Ashatu Sunnah.
Yes, sir. I have all
this. And Jild 7.
Yes.
The volume 7.
Yes, sir.
في الأزنة في المرحلة فيما بين عام 1863 و1873، وهي الفترة الوحيدة التي كانت هناك لقاء بين سيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود وبين الإنجليز. وقد أشار أمير المؤمنين إلى أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أيضا عندما ذهب إلى سوريا وهو طفل صغير في 13 من عمره التقى بالراهب بحيرة هناك، ومن هنا قال بعض أعداء الإسلام أنه تعلم وعرف عن الأديان في ذلك الوقت وبعدها بسنوات طويلة ربما 30 عاما أو 27 عاما ادعى النبوة. فهناك تشابه بين الاثنين، بين الأستاذ وبين التلميذ. ثم ننتقل بعد ذلك إلى ما بعد عام. نعم، وهناك مشابهة في الفرق الزمني بين لقاء النصارى أو المسيحيين وبين دعوة النبوة. ثم بعد ذلك ننتقل إلى بعد عام 1868. قدم أمير المؤمنين أحد الشهود الآخرين. الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود بدأ يصنف الكتب في الدفاع عن الإسلام وإظهار محاسنه وكمالاته، وأول كتاب له وأعظم كتاب له هو كتاب البراهين الأحمدية، وهو 4 أجزاء. بدأ في تصنيفه عام 1880 الجزء الأول، حتى أخرج الجزء الأخير الرابع في عام 1884. والكتاب مليء بالحجج والأدلة والبراهين على جمال الإسلام وكماله وصدقه. والمسلمون في ذلك الوقت الذين كانوا يتعرضون لهجمات غير المسلمين من جميع الجبهات كانوا سعداء بهذا الكتاب جدا، لدرجة أن هناك عالم أشير إليه من قبل، هو الأستاذ أو العالم محمد حسين البطالوي، وهو من علماء أو كبير علماء أهل السنة أهل الحديث، وكان يحرر جريدة أو مجلة دينية تسمى إشاعة السنة. ففي الجزء السابع، المجلد السابع منها، في العدد في الصفحة رقم 169-170 كتب رأيه عن هذا الكتاب. وهذا شاهد من شخص في ذلك الوقت كان من المعجبين بالإمام المهدي، ولكن بعد ذلك ببضع سنوات في عام 1882 ادعى الإمام المهدي أنه الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود. وعند ذلك خالفه هذا الرجل العالم وقال عنه أشياء أخرى كثيرة. نسمع الآن ماذا قال عنه بعد نشر البراهين الأحمدية. نشر في مجلته المطبوعة ونسخها موجودة إلى الآن يقول: من رأينا أن هذا الكتاب أي البراهين الأحمدية ليس له نظير من قبل، وفيما يتعلق بالمستقبل الله تعالى يعلم ماذا سيحدث، ربما يحدث الله بعد ذلك أمرا. هو رجل عالم، وفي حدود ما اطلع عليه وقرأه من الكتب الدينية التي تدافع عن الإسلام لم يرى كتابا يدافع عن الإسلام بهذه الروعة وبهذا الجمال حتى وقته هذا. أما المستقبل فهو في يد الله. ثم قال أن مؤلف هذا الكتاب وتضحياته للإسلام بشخصه وبكتاباته وبكلامه يصعب أن نجد نظيرا له في تاريخ الإسلام كله. هو يعرف تاريخ المسلمين وجهادهم، فيصعب أن يجد مثل هذا الشخص في حياته وسلوكه وكتاباته وأعماله. ويقول أنه يأتي في مقدمة الذين دافعوا عن الإسلام منذ أول الإسلام إلى هذا الوقت، أي أنه في الوقت الذي احتاج فيه الإسلام إلى مدافعين حتى ذلك الوقت لم يوجد إنسان دافع عن الإسلام بهذه الطريقة، يقول في تاريخ الإسلام كله. ثم يقول أن هذا الرأي ربما يبدو فيه مبالغة، إذا أخذ أحد برأينا على أنه مبالغة شرقية، لأن الشرقيين معروفين بالمبالغة أحيانا، يقول فإننا نرد عليه ونقول: أحضر لنا كتابا واحدا عرض فيه الإسلام بهذا الجمال ودفع فيه عن الإسلام ورد في مواجهة كل الأديان وخصوصا الأديان الهندية الأريسماج وغيرها والبرهمسماج، وأرونا ثلاثة أو أربعة أسماء من أبطال الذين دافعوا عن الإسلام بالكلمة وبالجهاد، هذا النوع من الجهاد، يكونون مثل هذا الشخص. إذن
في
تاريخ الإسلام كله. إذن هو ليست شهادة، الرجل يتحدى الناس جميعا أن يأتوا بمثال لكتاب المسيح الموعود أو بشخص مثل المسيح الموعود في ذلك الوقت. هذا الشخص أصبح بعد ذلك عدوا للمسيح الموعود، ولكن لا يهم، لأن هذا القول قاله عندما لم تكن بينه وبين المسيح الموعود عداوة، لأنه في ذلك الوقت لم يقل إني مأمورة أو أن لي صفة معينة، ولكنه يستمر في قوله فيقول، طبعا لم يتقدم أحد لهذا التحدي، يقول هذا دافع عن الإسلام أو ليس له نظير ليس بالكتابة فقط، ولكن هذا الرجل كاتب مؤلف هذا الكتاب تحدى بشجاعة عظيمة وقوة رائعة ليس أصحاب الأديان فقط بل والملحدين والمنكرين لوجود الله، وقال لهم: تعالوا أنتم تنكرون الوحي والإلهام من السماء، أنا أتلقى هذا الوحي، تعالوا وأنا أثبت لكم أن الوحي حقيقة من الله سبحانه وتعالى. إلى هذه اللحظة لم يعارض مولانا محمد حسين البطالوي عندما قال إنه يتلقى الوحي بصفته إنسانا مأمورا.
When he, Mawlvi Muhammad Hussain Bhatali and the like of him opposed him later on, you know what Hazrat Mirza Sahib said in response? He said, فَقَدْ لَبِثُ فِيكُمْ عُمَرًا مِنْ قَبْلِهِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. The same verse which is present, which is which you find in the Quran in defense of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He used the same argument. He said, you are the people who stood witness to the entire life of more than 40 years of absolute righteousness and defense of Islam. Suddenly you say, I am the worst man? How could we accept your testimony now?
يشير أمير المؤمنين إلى أن مولانا محمد حسين البطالوي وغيره من العلماء عندما هاجموا المسيح الموعود بعد ذلك وبدأوا يطعنون في شخصه، قال لهم ما يقوله القرآن بالنسبة للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: فقد لبثت فيكم عمرا من قبله أفلا تعقلون. هذه الحجة التي جاءت في القرآن عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لقومه، القرآن يتحدث بلسانه، قل لهم إنك لبثت فيهم 40 سنة صادقا أمينا معروفا بالخلق القويم ليس فيك أي عيب ولا يعرفون عنك منكر.
ثم فجأة تتحول إلى غير ذلك ويغيرون رأيهم فيك. أيضا المسيح الموعود عاش معهم هذا العمر الطويل وهو مشهود له بالصلاح والتقوى والورع والدفاع عن الإسلام، ثم يقرضون ما يكتبه وفجأة ينقلبون ضده. هل هو تغير؟ السنة الإلهية تقول لا، لا يتغير، لبثت فيكم عمرا من قبله، أفلا تعقلون؟ الإنسان لا يتغير بهذه الطريقة.
Yes, حضور.
Next.
Yes. This is his books from 68 till he said that I am the right. Imam Mahdi. Right. What are his achievements during this period?
You see, this is the question which covers a very wide area of his activities. I would like you to specify in which area of his activities you would like me to
yes, like.
You see, I can suggest, for instance,
yes,
his services in favor of Islam as opposed in opposition to the enemies of Islam, like Christians, Buddhists, people of all faith, and Hindus and Sikhs, everybody inclusive. What were his services in that area? Number two, the question could be raised as to what he did in Islam if he claimed to be a perfect obedient servant of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if he claimed to be a 100% subservient to Islam and the Holy Quran, what addition did he make? What new thing did he bring? So why should we believe in him? What is the need for believing in him when he doesn't seem to have added anything upon Islam, and this is his own claim? So what did he do to deserve the title of Imam Mahdi, and what services he rendered to the Holy Quran, which was already perfect, or to the Hadith, which was the word of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and nothing could be attributed to him later on? This is also a very important question.
Yes.
So, use other questions.
Yes, sir. We will
specify.
Yes, we'll start. Yes. Let me tell to the audience.
أمير المؤمنين يقول لا أجيب على هذا السؤال الواسع هكذا. لماذا لا نجعله على هيئة عناوين عندما نتحدث عن ما حققه الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود في الفترة من عام 1868 إلى أن قال أنا الإمام المهدي أو أنا المسيح الموعود؟ هو كانت له أعمال كثيرة. إذن نبدأ بالسؤال الذي اقترحه حضوره، هو إن شاء الله الذي سيجيب عليه. ما هي الخدمات الخدمات التي قام بها فيما يتعلق بالدفاع عن الإسلام في مواجهة النصارى وغيرهم من أصحاب الديانات الأخرى؟
Right.
Yes, sir.
So, you also tell them in English, the listeners.
Yes.
What question you want me to answer?
The question would be the services rendered by the promised Messiah before he claimed that he was the promised Messiah in favor of Islam against the other religions.
Right. You see, first of all, he claimed that Islam is the most perfect religion in all teachings, and the Holy Quran is a perfect book in which you cannot find a single, even a dot which has been added by man, or you cannot point at even a dot which has been taken out of the Quran by human hands. So not only a perfect book, but a perfectly guarded book. This is the claim he made in his debates with Christians, with Hindus, with other faiths, and said, if you can bring a book to prove that this book equals the Holy Quran in this regard, show me. And in this area he had huge debates with all religions, or many important religions I should say, and proved beyond a shadow of doubt that the Holy Quran was perfect in its right in its claim of perfection, and right in its claim of perfect security from
interpolation by human hands. That is, نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الزِّكْرَ إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الزِّكْرَ وَإِنَّهُ لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. This one small area of his services belong to this field.
يقول أمير المؤمنين إن النقطة الأولى في خدماته للإسلام هي إعلانه أن الإسلام هو أكمل العقائد، كل تعاليمه هي الكمال، وأنه ليس هناك في الديانات الأخرى أي تعليم يفضل تعاليم القرآن وأن تعليم الإسلام، وأن القرآن كتاب الإسلام هو كتاب كامل، كل حرف فيه من عند الله تعالى، ليس ليد البشر فيه أي شيء، لا إضافة نقطة ولا حذف نقطة، كل كلمة فيه وكل حرف هي من عند الله تعالى، وأنه لا يمكن أن يوجد كتاب نظيره في العالم، لا في حفظه كاملا ولا في ما يحتوي عليه من تعاليم كاملة. هذا هو النقطة الأولى التي قام بها في ذلك الوقت، ودخل في مناظرات طويلة وعديدة مع الديانات، أهل الديانات الكبيرة في ذلك الوقت، وبفضل الله تعالى تغلب وأظهر صدق دعواه إلى أقصى حد.
Another point which he raised is very important too. He said, not only do I say that no change was made in the book by human hands, but he also claimed that no change was made by God himself either. There was no nasikh, no mansukh. While prior to him, the Muslim scholars of centuries had gone even to the extent of believing that at one time 500 verses of the Holy Quran were involved in nasikh mansukh.
I remember 512.
512, that's right, yes. And later on, the closest to him was Shawaliullah Muhaddis Dehlavi, who said that I have been able to, many scholars before him attempted to resolve the contradictions, they thought the contradictions, and said we have discovered everything is all right. Prior to him, Ibn Arabi claimed that there are only 21 verses which belong to this category. The rest is the failure of ulama to understand. And Sayyid Waliullah Shah Muhaddis Dehlavi, he said, no, no, even he was mistaken. There were 5 such verses. Hazrat Masih Maud Rasulullah Sallam, there is not one. And I challenge the whole world, whoever points at a contradiction, that this seems to be a contradiction, so both could not be right. I can prove, and he did prove, without a shadow, but beyond a shadow of doubt, that the Quran was neither changed by human hands nor changed by God himself. And when he claimed this, he challenged others to present their books in the same light. He said, I am going to prove that the opposite is true about your books. There you find the change, the hand of change, in two ways. God revealed revelations and changed them in accordance with the change of time and the need of the age. And human hands, oh, they played havoc with their books. So this single service alone is so wonderful,
yes,
that if you read the history of Muslim scholars, you'll be surprised at how much he had written on this and how he pinpointed the area of debate which would prove Islam to be the right and the others to be wrong.
ويوضح أمير المؤمنين فيما يتعلق بكمال القرآن وحفظ الله تعالى له، وأن نحن إن نحن نزلنا الذكر وإن له لحافظون. يقول أن قبل مجيء الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود كان علماء المسلمين يعتقدون بوجود النسخ في القرآن، أي أن هناك آيات قرآنية قد نسخت إما بالقرآن أو بالحديث أو بما يشاءون. ومن العلماء المسلمين من رأى أن هذا خطأ وحصر النسخ في عدد محدود من الآيات، فابن عربي قال إن هذه الآيات المنسوخة 21 آية. ثم جاء من بعده المجدد المشهور شاه ولي الله محدث الدهلوي، قال لا، عدد الآيات المنسوخة فقط 5. ولكن الإمام المهدي عندما جاء قال ليست هناك أي آية في القرآن منسوخة مطلقا، كل آية في القرآن معمول بها منذ جاء بها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى يوم القيامة، لا تحريك في أي نقطة ولا همسة ولا أي شيء في القرآن كما نزل من عند الله إلى أن يرث الله الأرض ومن عليها. وتحدى غير المسلمين في كتبهم، قال لهم إني أستطيع أن أبين لكم عكس ذلك في كتبكم. القرآن محفوظ ليس فيه تغيير ولا تبديل، لا بالحذف ولا بالزيادة، ولكن كتبكم حدث فيها هذا. أستطيع أن أبين أن حدثت عندكم تغييرات إلهية، أن هناك آيات أو أوامر إلهية ثم نسخت بعد ذلك في نفس هذه الكتب، والبشر غيروا في هذه الآيات بما شاءوا وأحدثوا فيها ما شاءوا. أما القرآن فإن الله لم يغير فيه آية، وليس لإنسان ولا يستطيع إنسان أن يغير فيه حرفا واحدا. وهذه وحدها لو كانت هي المهمة التي قام بها الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود لكانت كافية لأن يخلد في التاريخ وأن يكون بطلا من أبطال الإسلام.
Another, you know, I'll raise, I'll inform you the principles in the light of which he fought the battles for Islam. He didn't take up the cudgel haphazardly, this and that. He first clearly laid down principles which had to be accepted by the enemy as the sound principles. Then he challenged them to come and have a debate. For instance, he said, a teaching which claims to be universal has to make this claim clearly and in clear words in the book itself. If you attribute this claim to the books and we don't find it there, then it is just meaningless. You're not God, you have no right to claim the quality of a book which the book itself does not claim. So he challenged them. He said, I am going to prove that the teachings of Islam is universal according to the claim of the Quran, and I will prove that the Prophet of Islam is universal according to the claim of Quran. We'll take up the debate later on, but first bring those references with you where your books have made the same claims, where Old Testament has made the claim about Moses, New Testament about Jesus Christ, that he is a universal prophet. No such claim is made. And he fought his battles most successfully. And he said, from the Quran I am going to say, so if the claim is not there, what is the point in debating this? But he said, no, I'm not running away. There is no claim, yet I'm going to fight this on other grounds.
يبين أمير المؤمنين أن سيدنا الإمام المهدي والمسيح الموعود عندما كان يدافع عن الإسلام ويدخل في مناقشات ومباحثات مع غير المسلمين كان لا يفعل ذلك خط عشواء، ولكنه كان يضع الأسس والقواعد السليمة التي يمكن أن ينبني عليها حتى لا يتعاملوا معه بهذه الطرق الملتوية، ولا بد أن يأخذ اتفاقهم واعترافهم بهذه المبادئ. فمثلا في موضوع العالمية يقول أنا أدعي أن القرآن والإسلام دين عالمي للعالم كله، أن محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبي للعالم كله، علي أن أثبت هذا من القرآن من كتاب الإسلام، علي أن أثبت هذا من أقوال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
He said it is for me to prove that this is the claim of the Quran.
Yes.
From the Quran.
Yes.
You first prove your claim.
Yes.
From
yes.
your own books.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. أما إذا كانت عندكم ادعاء بأن دينكم دين عالمي فعليكم أن تخرجوا لنا ذلك من كتابكم. إذا كان كتابكم يقول إنه دين عالمي أو كتاب عالمي إذا نأخذ به ونبحث هذا الموضوع. وأنا إذا ادعيت أن القرآن أو نبي الإسلام نبي عالمي والقرآن كتاب عالمي، فعلي أن أبين أن هذا موجود في القرآن وموجود في أقوال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وعلى هذا الأساس يمكن أن يبدأ النقاش. في النقاط الأخرى أيضا وضع مثل هذه القواعد.
But then he again started debating. He said, even if you can't prove, I'm going to prove from the comparison between teachings that your claim is wrong anyway. But of that we'll speak tomorrow, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Because he's telling me the time is over.
Okay.
You better state this much.
Inshallah. يقول أمير المؤمنين أنه قال لو أنكم استطعتم أن تأتوا بهذا الدليل أو لم تستطيعوا أن تأتوا بهذا النص من كتبكم، فسوف أبين أنا أن هذا ليس صحيح ومن نصوص كتابكم وبمقارنتها مع تعاليم القرآن وتعاليم أديانكم وكتبكم.
إن شاء الله.
نستكمل هذا إن شاء الله في اللقاء القادم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.